Hello and welcome to In the Making, a series of conversations from North Bennett Street School where we connect with a range of new voices, fields, and perspectives. Before we get into our conversation, I want to thank and recognize the Dora Foundation and Eaton Vance for making this program possible. Welcome everyone, my name is Kristen Odell. I'm an NBSS staff member and host of In the Making. Much like the city of Venice, Italy, Boston's history and industry has been closely linked to the water. And so today we cross waters over to Venice into the shop of Paolo Brandolizio, one of five remaining carvers of the forcola, or oarlock, a specifically functioning and custom-made piece of the Venetian gondola. Our friends Sebastian and Emma will be our eyes, ears, and voice today, sharing the sights and translating our program as we speak with Paolo about his work and the health of Venice. Hello, Emma and Sebastian and Paolo, ciao.
Ciao.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Hello. Thank you to everybody for being here, and thank you to Paolo, Emma, and Sebastian for making this possible on your end. We're so excited. I'm just gonna dive right into the bottom line here. Paolo, can you please tell us what is the forcola?
Che cos'è la forcola?
La forcola è l'appoggio per il remo di una barca veneziana, magari una gondola o un altro tipo di barca, sempre di Venezia. È lo scalmo dove si poggia il remo in varie posizioni.
Okay, so the forcola is the oarlock, and it's the support for the oars for the gondola, so that the gondolier can row the boat in different positions.
Se volete vi spiego I punti di appoggio.
If we want, he'll explain how the gondolier rests the oar in different positions against the forcola.
Yes, please. And then while you're setting that up or talking to us about it, Paolo, do you make these custom per gondolier? They're custom made per person?
Lo fai per il cliente a posto oppure vengono fatti così?
Sì, si fanno su misura del cliente perché è molto importante l'altezza, perché poi quando si voga c'è una diagonale del remo e quindi il remo deve appoggiare su un punto in cui non sei troppo alto né troppo basso e deve agevolare il movimento che si fa. Quindi quando si costruisce una forcola nuova si cambiano dei dettagli in base al cliente, alle esigenze del cliente.
Okay, so it's very important that the forcola is custom made because each gondolier is different. As people with different heights, we have different positions, and the gondolier likes to be able to choose the position in which they row. And so Paolo makes it according to the needs of the client. So sometimes it can be a little bit higher, a little bit lower, exactly as the client wants it, so that it'll fit perfectly on their gondola. So custom made is very important.
Questa è una forcola da gondola.
This is a gondola forcola.
Questa è molto usata, quindi potete vedere anche bene dove appoggeremo il gondoliere.
And so you can see in the shiny bit at the top. I'm not quite sure if you
allora,
can get that.
I movimenti che fa il gondoliere. Ovviamente il gondoliere è qui. E quando parte con il remo fa questa vogata, diciamo, corta.
Okay, so when the gondolier starts, he leans the oar against the side, just as Paolo is showing us now, and that's how the gondolier pushes off. So he starts on the side of the forcola.
Sempre qui, comunque in questa posizione, in questa zona, voga quando dove è sul canale stretto o quando ci sono delle altre barche che passano.
Right, so in this area, this is where the gondolier would row, on a very thin, tiny, tight canal, or maybe when there's another boat going past. So if you get some traffic, you use that area there.
Ecco qui è la vogata normale.
And this is the ordinary rowing.
È la parte più consumata.
The part that's been worn away the most.
Se deve tornare indietro, lui si gira e voga all'indietro in questa posizione qui col remo.
Right, so if the gondolier has to go backwards, then he puts the oar in this direction.
Ecco, amazing. Poi qui per esempio si ferma e gira subito a destra la gondola.
Okay, this is the place where he stops and he turns right.
Mentre qui, questo adesso è consumato, ma è una specie di gancio in cui lui fa una forza contraria per come se tirasse il freno a mano di colpo.
Right, and this part it's been worn away because this is an old forcola, but usually it would be a sort of lock and it would be more like a handbrake, so the gondolier can stop the gondola straight away.
Poi, per esempio, qui invece fa una curva subito a sinistra.
And this is for a left-hand turn.
Quindi questa posizione, poi qui lo stesso quando voga sui canali. Comunque, 7-8 posizioni per fare tutte le direzioni punto da solo.
There are about 7 or 8 different positions that the gondolier would need to learn using the forcola to row the gondola.
Wonderful. Paolo, can you tell us how many forcolas do you make in, say, a year?
Quanti lo fai in un anno?
Di solito ne faccio 10, 12 di nuove.
About 10 to 12 new ones.
Vedete anche questa forcola, per esempio, adesso ne ho fatto una nuova per il gondoliere, perché quando diventa troppo largo, poi si va male a vogare, l'appoggio diventa più difficoltoso.
Right, this one, he's just made a new one for the gondolier who owned this forcola, and you can see how it's worn away. And when it gets worn away, the gondolier can't row properly, because he doesn't have the strength to maneuver the gondola with the oar.
Però si può anche riparare, cioè si taglia il pezzo, si aggiunge un pezzo nuovo e si rifà, questa parte la chiamiamo morso, e si rifà questa parte come nuova.
Right.
Quindi può durare altri 25 anni.
Ok, so this can be repaired. Paolo would cut off the top of the forcola and add on a new piece of wood and shape it to fit. This part at the top is called the bite, and so the forcola, the oarlock, would last another 25 years.
Quindi due vite di gondolieri.
Two lifetimes.
Wow. So is that actually the full lifespan of one? If one existed to be used, how many years could one fully be used?
Quanti anni puoi usare in pieno funziona una forcola?
Diciamo che quando arriva a 15-20 anni comincia a essere troppo largo.
Mm-hmm. So però 15 to 20 years it starts to stretch and it's too big to row.
C'è qualche gondoliere che ha fatto tutta la sua vita lavorativa con una forcola.
Right, there are a few gondoliers who have had their whole working life with just one forcola, but this is unusual.
Wow.
Vuole un albero che ha 50 anni, però poi dura altri 50. rispetto.
You need a tree trunk that's 50 years old, but that tree trunk will last another 50 years in its life as a forcola.
Mm. So that's a good segue into the next question I have is, can you talk to us about the materials, Paolo? What are the woods and what are the most important tools that you're using?
Prima che tipo di legno usi per fare la forcola e dopo gli attrezzi che usi per farlo.
Allora si usa questa è di noce, ma Walnut. Si usa anche il pero, il ciliegio.
Cherry.
E il motivo è perché la venatura è molto omogenea, non fa schegge, non ha venature più dure come la quercia. E come vedete, quando si consuma, è molto liscia.
Mm-hmm. So these woods are perfect.
Non ci sono schegge.
We wanted to show you how smooth this here is. There's no splinters.
Questo, essendo un legno duro, quindi dura molto, no, nella vita.
These hardwoods are perfect for the forcola because they need to last a lifetime. And when they wear smooth. Instead of wearing away with splinters, the wood will be solid enough to support the rowing and the oar. And that's why the choice of tree helps.
And Emma, just a question for Paolo, is it are you using a combination of all those three woods in one forcola, or do you use... Does one forcola consist of one species?
Ecco, come vedete sull'immagine, quello è il pezzo principale, è un quarto del tronco. Si usa un pezzo unico.
So, just one wood.
Si taglia in 4 pezzi perché si elimina la parte centrale che è debole.
Right. So when you have the tree trunk, he cuts out the center of the trunk because that's the weakest part. And he uses a quarter of a very, very large tree to make the forcola.
Il quarto resta lì 2 anni perché deve asciugarsi bene, sennò poi si crepa.
So
e poi si può cominciare a tagliare.
Right. So the wood has to stay in the workshop drying for at least 2 years.
Almeno 2 anni. Poi
at least two. Otherwise. Otherwise, it's too wet and you can't carve it properly.
It takes a long time to
season the wood to enable him to work it properly.
Mm-hmm. And we know your draw knife that you use. Can you show us that tool?
Yep. Okay.
And also, sorry, also...
Uno degli attrezzi principali è questo.
Yeah, this is the draw knife he's showing us now.
Si usa così.
And this is how you use it. Let's give us a little demonstration.
And a question for Paolo is, what are the other key tools in this process?
Gli altri attrezzi sono molto importanti per questo processo.
Allora, c'è un altro attrezzo a mano, che è questa...
Another hand tool.
Vedete questa sega qui.
Which is this saw here.
Che è molto sottile.
It's very, very thin.
E questa serve per tagliare a mano le parti più strette.
Mm-hmm. And this helps to cut by hand the bite at the top of the forcola and the details.
Questa forcola che è piccola anche delle parti del corpo.
Mm-hmm. And this one that's very small, he'd use it to cut the body.
Invece sulle forcole grandi da gondola si taglia, molte parti si tagliano con la sega elettrica.
And now the very, very big forcola for the gondolas, he would use the electric saw as well.
Questi sono per fare una forcola... C'è la sega elettrica, la sega a mano e quel ferro lì. Poi per rifinire la carta vetrata e qualcosa.
Right. So to make it, you've got the electric saw, the hand saw, the draw knife, and right at the end, the sandpaper.
Mentre nel passato, quando non c'era l'elettricità...
Okay, so in the past, when there wasn't electricity in the bottega, that's the workshop.
L'attrezzo principale era questo qui.
Okay, so in the past, this used to be the main tool used, which is a sort of axe, and it's heavy.
E quindi questo serviva perché si facevano sul tronco, si facevano dei tagli, e poi con questo si toglieva tutto il... La parte più scarto, diciamo.
Right, this was used. You made a cut on the very big tree trunk, and then this one was used to chip away gently at the wood to get the shape.
Mm. Questa è il testimone che mi ha lasciato il mio maestro. È stato lasciato al papà del mio maestro dal suo maestro.
Right. So this fantastic tool, this axe, has been passed down through 3 generations of forcola makers. It was passed to Paolo from his teacher and mentor, and before that it was passed from his mentor. So it's gone through 3 generations.
And I think Paolo, and we're going to get into that in a moment, but I think, Paolo, did you say that your mentor, he had a huge right arm from that axe?
Aveva, perché yeah. Questo pezzo è molto pesante, ma è pesante
heavy.
Perché deve tagliare il legno duro, quindi l'abilità era di direzionare, di fare il taglio giusto, ovviamente mm-hmm. un ceppo, e quindi il polso del mio maestro era più grosso del mio, e poi anche la parte del muscolo qui era molto un po' come Popeye.
So Paolo says it's a bit like Popeye. The sailor, and he had a huge wrist and a huge forearm because you had to have that muscle strength to be able to use this tool correctly. And it's not about giving a brute force from a height. It was about controlling it within the little movements. And because it's so heavy with the way that it's weighted, it enables you to chip away at the wood, even very hard woods. And it gives
volete,
you...
Vi mostro
he says tool. He'll show us if we would like.
Sure. While we're going into that area, can I get Paolo? Can you talk to us about how you found yourself in this craft?
Puoi spiegare un po' come sei trovato in questo mestiere?
Io quando ero ragazzo facevo dei lavori, lavoretti a casa in legno, così nella soffitta della casa, dove il mio zio aveva un banco da falegname, perché anche lui faceva delle cose. E mio zio mi ha detto: prova a fare una forcola, e quindi ho copiato una forcola di quelle della barca che avevamo. E poi sono venuto qui in questa bottega dove c'era Giuseppe Carli, a chiedere cosa pensava del mio lavoro. Avevo circa 16 anni e lì, diciamo, ho iniziato il rapporto, perché poi lui mi ha detto: sì, qui c'è un difetto, insomma, abbiamo parlato, e poi mi ha detto: farne un'altra. E in quel momento mi ha detto: ti do io il pezzo di legno, e mi ha assegnato questo piccolo pezzo di legno, era una piccola miniatura di forcola. E lì è iniziato il rapporto. Poi quella forcola che ho fatto, anche sotto il suo insegnamento, me l'ha lasciata e fa anche abbastanza schifo. Comunque poi probabilmente ha visto che capivo qualcosa, non so.
Right, so it started when Paolo was younger. He used to work with wood at home. It was a hobby. His uncle up in the attic of his house had a wood workshop and used to make little things out of wood. And one day his uncle said to him, why don't you copy this forcola that they had? It was not a gondola forcola. It was one for a normal boat. So it was the orlop for their family boat. And so Paolo copied it, and he thought he'd done a pretty good job. So he took it along to the workshop to show Giuseppe Carli, giusto, to show the previous owner, his teacher, the work that he'd done. And his teacher looked at him and he said, okay, why don't you try doing another one? And he gave him another piece of wood, which Paolo then carved. And clearly his teacher saw lots of potential in him. He saw some talent, some raw talent in Paolo. Paolo says when he looks at the forcola that he made way back when, he says it's horrible. He says it's absolutely terrible. But as a start in the trade, it was it kind of gave him a motive to carry on.
Wonderful. And that speaks, going back to your mentor, your Carli, how important is being born and raised in Venice to doing this work?
Quanto è importante di essere nato e cresciuto a Venezia per fare questo lavoro?
Beh, è importante perché delle cose di questo mestiere, cioè il remo, la forcola, sai già, almeno quando ero ragazzo io, avevo imparato un po' a vogare, quindi sai delle cose che ti spiegano mio papà, mio zio, del movimento, insomma. Quindi riesci già a capire delle cose. È ovvio che fare queste cose è tutt'altro, insomma. Da fuori sai cosa si può usare, cosa serve, e sai manovrarle, però per costruirle è tutta un'altra cosa. Vederle da fuori una forcola la vedi in una maniera diversa quando comincia a costruirla, sembra proprio un'altra roba.
So it's fundamental, really, because it's always been part of his life. He always had the forcola on the boat, the orlop was on the family boat, and he learned to row at a very young age, and so he was always using the forcola, the orlop, and it was part of the culture, really. He grew up with it surrounding him. It was as normal for us as it is to get in the car and drive as it is for him to get in the boat and use the forcola, use the orlop to row. And so really, somebody who comes from outside doesn't have the same link. They can look at the forcola and say, oh yes, I understand, I get it's an orlock and I can use it, but it's not got that connection in the same way that a real Venetian has. Mm-hmm. And then when you start to make it and use it, that's a craft that takes years and years and years to learn, and it's not something that comes overnight, but it's something he's born into, and he thinks that's very important for him.
We discussed this at another time, but Paolo, you've said that so essentially being born of the water is, you know, makes this sort of, you have to have that connection to the water to be making the forcola. And I think I asked you before, do you see yourself living anywhere else other than Venice?
c'hai questo collegamento con l'acqua per questo mestiere, puoi vedere la vita vissuta in un'altra parte oltre a Venezia.
Ma sì, dentro di me c'è sempre stato questo amore per la montagna, per la terra. È un po' una contraddizione, ma capisco che è bello anche così, sapere che si può fare qualcos'altro.
I heard earth in there.
Yes, he does. He says he's a man of the earth, really, despite working and living by the water. But he loves the mountains, he loves the countryside. And it's a bit of a contradiction.
Mi piacciono il legno, mi piacciono anche gli alberi.
Maybe that it's linked to the woods, that he likes the forest and the mountains. And perhaps nature is strong because of his profession.
Right. I'm going to jump to another question for you, Paolo. Mm-hmm. We've just gone through a most challenging year globally. Venice is an extremely fragile city with flooding and over-tourism. What is the greatest challenge to your livelihood within the gondola tradition in this time?
Abbiamo appena passato un anno molto difficile da tanti punti di vista e Venezia ha sempre problemi con l'acqua alta e l'allagamento. Che cosa è il tuo punto di vista su questo aspetto? Cosa pensi verso la tua mestiere e questi problemi che ha Venezia?
Sì, il mio mestiere, come quasi tutti qua a Venezia, sono legati al turismo. Perché? Perché la città non è più una città, è un museo vivente, si può dire.
Right, so his job is connected to the tourism because Venice has become a living museum for the tourists.
Però, capito, siamo sopra un castello di carte, quindi...
We're on top of a paper house of cards.
Abbiamo visto con l'acqua alta del 2019 che appena succede qualcosa che impedisce questo flusso di turisti, siamo...
Yeah, as soon as something happens, like the high water we had in 2019, it's very difficult because when the tourists don't come, Venice collapses.
E purtroppo questa cosa non è successa ieri, cioè questa cosa è cioè Venezia così è diventata da 40 anni a sta parte, cioè è cominciata 40 anni fa. Non si è fatto praticamente niente per avere un minimo di alternativa e questo è il risultato.
Right, he says that this isn't a new problem. This is a problem that's been brewing for over 40 years mm-hmm. and that the city could have done something about this to help with the tourists and supporting the local economy, but nothing's been done. So it's not a new problem, but it's something that resonates very clearly with all of the Venetians in their life.
Poi io sono un artigiano fortunato perché in qualche modo dai turisti ho diciamo portato avanti questo mio mestiere, questa mia passione, ma non sono bravo, capito? Nel senso che mi dico bravo, porti avanti la tradizione. No, sono stato fortunato perché i gondolieri hanno sempre aumentato il lavoro e quindi ha aumentato il mio lavoro. Altri artigiani più bravi di me, forse non lo so, hanno chiuso perché non c'è più il mercato.
Right.
Quindi...
So Paolo considers himself a very lucky artisan in that because of the tourists, his job has gone ahead because there's this constant need for gondolas and they all need to have the oarlock on their boat. So there are lots of people that come to Paolo and they say, oh, yes, well done, aren't you amazing? Look at you carrying on this craft. And Paolo said, it isn't about me being really good at this craft. It's I'm just lucky. And there might be other artisans who are perhaps equally talented, if not more so, who've had to close their workshops and can't work in Venice because there isn't the demand for what they're producing anymore.
And I think we discussed this at a different time. What was this past year like as far as giving the city back to you as artisans? What happened in that?
Com'è andato questo anno di Covid? È successo che è stato ridato a voi, i veneziani, la città, come si doveva essere?
Diciamo che era un... Proprio, diciamo, siamo passati da un eccesso all'altro.
We went from one excess to the other.
E il problema è che non ci sono più i veneziani. siamo pochissimi. Quindi...
The problem is there are very few real Venetians.
Quindi la città era una città quasi fantasma nelle zone più turistiche, tipo San Marco, Rialto. Diciamo, siamo 50.000 residenti. Diciamo che 20.000 sono sopra i 70 anni, compresa mia mamma, ne ha 88, ma quella, no, non si vedono quelle persone lì, non vivono nel senso buono, cioè nel senso che non portano a essere cittadini pienamente, sono cittadini marginali purtroppo, e quelli un po' alla volta spariscono, però non ce ne sono di nuovi, quindi il problema diventa che nel momento in cui no, la città non è più una città, sono spariti, spariscono anche gli abitanti.
Right. So the problem was that Venice during the lockdown and COVID became a ghost city, really, because there are maybe 50,000 inhabitants in Venice, and perhaps 20,000 of those are over 70. And so he says that that you don't see them. They aren't the life and soul of the city in the way that perhaps it should be. And so he says when those people pass, there aren't the young people coming up, and it just becomes a shell of a city because of the lack of young people that there are in Venice.
A sort of personal question for you, Paolo. As a Venetian who uses his hands to keep the cultural fiber of Venice going, talking to a non-Venetian, tell me, what is your favorite thing about Venice?
Sei un artigiano che usa le mani per creare qualcosa, e per te, dal tuo prospettiva come artigiano, cosa è la cosa che preferisci di più su Venezia?
Nel senso di come cosa preferisco vivere
what,
nella città?
In the sense of what he likes, how he likes to live the city, or what he likes to see in the city?
I guess either or. I just kind of want to hear, your most special thing about the culture that you have been born and raised in and are still contributing to with your hands.
Right. La cosa che preferisci di più di Venezia, magari artigianale, che come fai tu con le mani, e altri mestieri, altre cose che ti piacci di Venezia, che sono... Anche di oggi.
Di oggi? Beh, sicuramente il rapporto che c'è fra la città e l'acqua è un rapporto particolare che esiste solo qua, non perché ci siano altre città che hanno l'acqua vicino, ma è proprio, e tutti ci accorgiamo quando facciamo un giro in barca, che sembra un altro tipo di città. Quando cammini a piedi, quando vai in barca, quando solo fai qualcosa di diverso, che potrete andare a fare la spesa in una città normale, è una cosa che puoi fare in qualsiasi città. Qui acquista un modo particolare, è più difficoltoso sotto certi aspetti, ma proprio per questo ha il suo fascino.
Yeah.
Quindi effettivamente ormai io sono abituato, ma l'altro giorno con una ragazza straniera che sta qui per lavoro, abbiamo attraversato Piazza San Marco e stavamo andando a fare la spesa. E lei era così, ha detto, ma come, non pensi che tu stai facendo la spesa e attraversi Piazza San Marco? Ho detto, no. Però il veneziano lo sente da bambino, e questa cosa che ti dà l'umanità.
Yeah.
L'umanità di essere in un posto umano.
Right. So he says it's the very special relationship that the Venetians have with the water. And when you go and see the city from a boat, it's a very different perspective. If you walk around the city, you see one part of Venice. On the boat, it's completely different. And he says even just the ordinary things like going and doing your shopping, you get in a boat, you go to the supermarket, you do your shopping, you put it in the boat and you come back. Even these things are part of the normal Venetian lifestyle. And for us, looking from outside, this seems really strange. And he said the other day he was going to do some shopping with a friend of his who's not Venetian. And they walked across St. Mark's Square. And she said, but do you realize you live here and you're doing your shopping walking across St. Mark's Square in the center of Venice. And Paolo said, oh, yeah, you're right. This is an amazing thing. And I think as a Venetian, sometimes you just take it for granted. It's part of the culture and part of how you are and how you live the city. But it's something very special, and the water gives Venice something that's totally unique.
Questo potrebbe essere il paradiso terrestre.
Paradise on earth.
Per i bambini.
For the children.
Per un bambino vuol dire che tutti possono starci bene.
Yeah, yeah.
And, it is paradise on earth, especially in the winter.
Everybody can be happy in this paradise on earth.
Can we ask, I want to ask about the back door where you have gondoliers can pull up and have the forcola removed and you can repair it on the spot. Can we see that back door?
Voleva chiedere dell'entrata sull'acqua che hai della bottega, su come le persone possono arrivare in barca diretto di avere qualcosa riparato in loco.
Sì, sì, di solito i gondolieri che sono qui vicino passano con la gondola e allora mi danno il remo rotto o comunque consumato e io gli passo il remo aggiustato.
So usually they just pull up at the back door of his workshop, which I think Sebastian's now showing you there.
Yes.
And they come up and they call him and they pass in the broken oar, whatever it is they have to repair. It's not always the oar lock. More often than not, it's the oars that break and wear away. And he gives them a new one and they give him the other one to be repaired and
poi
off they go.
Il canale qui serve anche quando devo mettere a posto l'assetto della forcola. Quindi il gondoliere viene con la gondola, si ferma qui un po' come la macchina quando vai dal meccanico. Ti fermi, io metto a posto la forcola, l'assetto, qualcosa, qualche problema che c'è sulla forcola e si fa il lavoro. Così, direttamente sul canale.
And so it's a bit like the car when it comes in at a pit stop or you take it to the mechanic. And the gondoliers come when they need to repair the set or the base of the forcola. Possiamo far vedere magari, Paolo?
Oh, is he going to show us?
Yeah, show you just the base of the
sì, questa
of the
parte che viene inserita sulla gondola. Magari faccio vedere.
Sì.
Sì. Allora, perché è importante anche l'assetto, cioè se va così, 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 insomma, si può cambiare la posizione se il gondoliere non si trova bene.
Right, so the base of the oarlock needs to be changed quite frequently. And I don't know if you can see, but there's been pieces added on to this oarlock.
Vedete, si aggiungono dei pezzi per cambiare l'assetto, perché questa va messa la mattina, poi la toglie, quindi c'è un supporto dove un buco dove va messa.
So this gets placed inside the gondola in the morning, and then in the evening the gondolier takes it out again. It doesn't stay in the boat the whole time. And often they like to change the angle. Sometimes they say, oh look, Paolo, I want to row it in a different way. I need to have another piece of wood added on. And you can see he's done that for them. And that's something he does here. And it's very useful to have the canal at the back of the workshop so that he can test it. And they can say, oh no, that's no good. We need it to be further back. We need it to be further over. It's like the Ferrari taking a pit stop. He says it's not always easy because you get some gondoliers who are a bit particular and a little bit fussy about how they want their oarlock to fit into the gondola. And so he says it's not always roses and flowers. Some of them are a bit, consider themselves quite sophisticated. So Paolo has to second their desires as clients, shall
right.
we say.
Can you show us? Can you show us how, can you put it in a boat for us? Do you have something
else
in the canal?
He's going to show you the forcola, the oarlock that fits into his boat, which
nice.
Is not quite the same as the one for the gondola. It's a bit different. Okay. Same. So it should fit in for you.
So Sebastian is following him out the back door to where his boat is.
Yes, where his boat is parked.
What a dream. Look at this. Wow. To our guests, we don't really have sound out there because of the two devices near one another. So I think we're just going to have to visualize through this moment.
So he says, he's just showing you, he says it just slots into the boat like this, and he's got the oar and the oar fits in. I think you can see quite clearly. It's at the angle that he needs to row his boat. So to go backwards, he says you do it like this. He's showing you the position. Or to brake, you'd go like this with the oar.
When he comes back in, I want to ask them about the ropes on the sides of the buildings. We saw a gondolier earlier pulling the rope to turn a corner.
Right. I'll ask him.
Oh, so now I see he's taking it back. It comes out of the boat. He's bringing it back inside.
And he said that's how you change the base. He's showing with a little piece of wood how you can add on and change the angle of the oarlock.
Oh, he's wedging it in. I see.
With the wood there.
Wow. Is Sebastian in the boat?
I think he is. Let's hope it's tied on.
Yes. Or this show is over. There he is.
Benissimo.
Thank you, Paolo.
Volevo chiedere delle corde che ci sono sulle case. È una cosa che un gondoliere o chi rema può aggrapparsi per
Avete visto
girare.
La corda
che
è fuori? Sì, no, sì, quella l'hanno messa i gondolieri per facilitare la curva.
Ah, non c'è dappertutto.
No.
All right, so the gondoliers stuck that bit of rope on the building to make it a bit easier for them.
In realtà, quando fanno la prova i gondolieri per diventare gondolieri,
right,
la prova in gondola non devi mettere mani, piedi, niente, devi fare tutto con i rem.
Right, I see. Quindi,
dopo ti fa tutto con i piedi.
So this is a very interesting piece of Venetian facts for you. That he says when the gondoliers are learning, they take a sort of driving test as you would to drive your car. When you do this test, you have to maneuver the gondola without touching any of the houses, without pushing off on the other boats, and you have to do sort of perfect turns just using your oar and the forcola, the oarlock. Whereas when they've passed their exam, they then hang on to anything they like. They push off the boats, they use their hands, they use their feet, they kick off the walls of the houses, and they drive their gondolas however they want to.
So they follow no rules.
No, not once they've passed the exam. So if when you come to Venice and you go in a gondola, you have to ask them not to touch any of the buildings, and you will that will be difficult for them. It'll be a bit of a challenge, but it's a good thing to show you whether you've got a really talented gondolier rowing your boat or not.
Yes, thank you for showing us the boat, Paolo. That was beautiful. I'm going to open up for Q&A for our guests, and I have to tell you that we already have a whole list of questions, so I'm just going to try to throw these out as efficiently as possible. Emma, if that's okay?
No problem, we're here.
I have so many questions. We've answered some of them. Do you decide, are you the decider of the wood for each forcola, or does the customer? Well, I think you already answered this. The customer chooses the wood.
Allora, sei tu che decidi il tipo di legno per la forcola o decide chi compra il gondoliere?
Diciamo che è una scelta quasi obbligata, perché prova solo quasi esclusivamente noce, ma diciamo anche tradizionalmente il noce è quello che valeva di più, è un po' un'idea. Una volta si aveva qualche forcola in più di ciliegio, di pero, perché costava meno quel legno lì.
Right.
Adesso forse costa di più, quindi ormai si tende ad andare sul noce quasi esclusivamente.
Okay, in theory the client would have a choice, but in reality it's mostly walnut that he uses because the cherry and pear are a bit harder to find. And it used to be that walnut was the rarer wood and more difficult to come across. And so cherry and pear were used a bit more. And he says he's got one or two forklers made of that. Mm-hmm. But now it's mostly all walnut. So they don't really have much of a choice.
Got it. And that answers a couple other people's questions. It's walnut, cherry, and pear. Those are the three woods that mm-hmm. Paolo uses. For Paolo, do gondoliers normally have a spare forcola so that if one's being repaired, they can use the spare? Or do you give out loaners, like a loaner car?
Ah no, tengono una di scorta, tipo la ruota nella macchina, oppure quando vengono qua devono riparare, hai una forcola in più che lo presti a loro mentre no, che ripari?
Quasi sempre, quasi tutti hanno una forcola a casa di riserva.
Mm-hmm, they do, they all, most of them at home have a spare.
O una nuova.
Or an old one, or even
qualcuno
a new one.
No, ha solo quella e quando la rompe, no. Io non ne ho di riserva, magari
he doesn't have any,
non rinunciano a lavorare, quindi prendono la gondola di uno che è a casa di riposo.
All right, so if somebody only has one forcola for their gondola and it breaks and it needs repairing, then they come and he...
Sono un po' impegnato.
This is a working workshop.
It is, we're open for business.
Yes. So if they need a forcola, then they tend to borrow a gondola from one of their friends or swap around with somebody else they know, because Paolo doesn't have any spares.
Got it. Wow. That's incredible. That's not what I expected. But let me jump to another question. Is there any competition out there from makers using other materials other than wood, like carbon fiber? Or is anybody out there making forcolas out of non-wood?
Allora, c'è competizione di qualcuno che fa la forcola usando le materie nuove, i fibre di carbone oppure le cose che non sono legno?
No, che sappia io, non c'è nessuno che ha fatto certe cose così.
As far as he knows, nobody's ever tried to make
one. C'è uno che fa barche, che ha fatto la forcola incollando pezzi di legno e usando una macchina accoppiatrice.
Right, so there was somebody who glued some pieces of wood together and made a forcola using a machine that copies the exact shape. So I guess that's computer technology as well.
Però non è stato un successo, nel senso
it wasn't a big success.
Understood.
Di fare una forcola con i legni incollati diventa che poi col sole, l'acqua e il sole può aprirsi.
So it's not a good idea to make a forcola out
of pieces that are made. Difficoltà poi a rogare per una persona diversa da
so it's hard because they're custom made according to the boat.
Mm-hmm.
We got another customer.
I know, I see this. I just think of the
with an oar here.
I think of the composite instruments. You know, we teach violin making here at North Bennett Street School, and as a musician throughout my life, I've seen those composite fiberglass instruments, and I'm sure it just makes, you know, it just causes a pain, you know, to see if he were to see all of a sudden composite made forcolas.
He says it doesn't work. It says he doesn't have the strength that it would need to maneuver the boat properly. Mm-hmm. So we're sorting out an oar problem here.
Okay, sure.
If they don't have the oars, they won't get home tonight with their boat. So do you want to give me another question that I can translate for him, Kristen, while we're waiting?
Yes, let me, I have so many here. Here's a great one. Does he have apprentice in his shop? Does he have any young people who come and apprentice in his shop? And the follow-up to that is, how does he see the craft enduring?
Right, I will ask him. Just give us a minute.
Sure, yep.
This is how Venice works, and this is the lovely thing about Venice, really, that people just pop in, have a chat, and when they're on their way back home or on their way to have a spritz or a glass of wine.
Well, also being a water city, you have no choice. This is like having a flat tire.
Yeah, it's not going to go anywhere without us all.
Yeah. I think we have somebody else coming in. Or no, I think the door is just ghost opening back behind you.
Weather's changing. It was beautiful and sunny here today, and now I think it's going to rain a bit.
Is it?
We'll see.
And yes. Are gondoliers still moving around in the rain? I mean, you still have to get places.
I think you do occasionally see them. The Italians tend to head for cover. They're a bit allergic to the rain, I think. They like to be undercover in the bar if it starts to. A few drops of rain, everybody's indoors. You do obviously get some who have to use their boats and go home. But
Emma, can you talk to us about what is your visceral feeling that you're having in Paolo's shop?
It's warm. It's friendly. It's quite cozy actually, because. I don't know if you can see above us, there are hundreds and hundreds of oars all up in the rafters, but it's actually very light. We've got a lot of natural light coming in from the ceiling, and that's one of the qualities of Venice, I guess, because of the way the light reflects off the water. You get a beautiful atmosphere, and Paolo's got his electric lights too, but it's a really nice feeling. Like, you could come in and have a cup of tea or a coffee and a chat.
No, tranquillo, il lavoro è quello che è, per questo siamo qua.
Certo.
C'è una città che vive, vogliamo così.
Apprentice.
So, yes, avevano chiesto se hai qualche apprendista, qualcuno che viene ad imparare questo mestiere, qualcuno che viene un po' oppure a tempo fisso.
Ma adesso c'è una persona, uno, non è proprio un ragazzo a 33 anni, che gli piacerebbe imparare, lui non è veneziano, è di Vicenza e stava qui un po' di tempo fa, allora veniva un po' d'estate a darmi una mano quando c'era più lavoro.
Ok, so he did have
ho fatto un allievo che ha una sua bottega 10 anni fa.
Great. Great. So he did have a guy who came and helped him last summer, a boy called him, but he's not really a boy because he's 33. And he's not Venetian, though. He comes from Vicenza, which is about an hour away. Yeah, he had to learn to row. Otherwise, you can't really do this. Paolo says it's no good being a land dweller, that he needed to learn to row to be able to do this craft. Some things you have to know to be able to do this. So he said that was fundamental for this guy. That was during the summer when Paolo was a bit busier. He had 10 years ago, he had his own student who he taught the craft. And this student now has his own workshop in Venice. So in that way, it is carrying on the craft.
Mm-hmm. A question, Paolo, do you ever collaborate with other artisans in Venice?
C'è mai l'opportunità di collaborare con altri artigiani in Venezia?
No, quando io faccio, per esempio, se il gondoliere vuole la forcola, vedete, così.
Okay, so if the gondolier wants a forcola that's decorated.
Allora c'è un altro artigiano che intaglia, che fa i lavori, i fiori, e un altro artigiano che mette l'oro, questo è oro vero, foglia di oro, che l'attacca. Quindi sono io e altri due artigiani, ma questo si arrangia il gondoliere, io faccio come la gondola, la gondola se la fa, è un io faccio la forcola, poi le due cose si mettono insieme, ma... Questi lavori sono stati divisi come i tempi della Repubblica, che c'erano le corporazioni, un po' così, e i clienti sono ancora abbastanza così.
Great. So,
è bello anche perché il cliente sceglie un po' quello che gli piace, come gli piace, capito?
Right.
Quindi non proprio come all'IKEA.
So Paolo says he does collaborate with other artisans, particularly if the gondoliere would like something more elaborate, something that's been carved. He will make the forcola, the orlock, and then he'll take it to another artisan who will carve it, and yet another artisan again will put on the gold leaf. He says that's made of pure gold. And so if a gondolier does want something decorated, then he can. But it is split up. The different artisans do different things. And he says it's been like that since Venice was a republic. So these are centuries old traditions that form part of how you make the forcola and how it's used. And the same thing with the gondola. He doesn't make gondolas, but he makes forcola, which is part of the gondola and needed to row it. But you have to collaborate and cooperate, but everybody has his separate specific role within that.
Poi è vero che uno deve sapere cosa fa l'altro un po', no? Deve capire il lavoro dell'altro, se no prepari qualcosa che poi non combacia. Quindi
right,
c'è anche questa particolarità di essere preparato, di capire.
Okay, and definitely, and you need to understand what the other artisans are doing. Because if you don't know how a gondola is made, then you can't make the forcola to fit in it. So although it's not a direct collaboration or cooperation, actually it all fits in as part of a puzzle together. And he has to know how the gondolas are made and how the other parts are constructed.
Mm-hmm.
So they work in sync together.
Mm-hmm. Paolo, your shop is so close to the water. Have you had flooding in your space?
Hai mai avuto problemi di acqua
alta? Sempre.
Always, he says.
Always.
Quasi come Piazza San Marco.
It's like San Marco.
Più bassi, la
it's very bottega. Low here in the workshop.
Quindi sì, so benissimo cosa.
Yeah, unfortunately, he knows very all too well what happens when you get the water.
Paolo, do you get any support from the Artisan Society of Venice?
Hai qualche sostegno della Società degli Artigiani di Venezia per queste cose?
No, non c'è stato mai quasi niente.
No, nothing.
No, tutti ci siamo arrangiati un po' come così, come va. Se ti va bene il lavoro, puoi farti delle cose, se non va bene...
They all sort of sort themselves out, really.
Ma l'artigianato da 40-50 anni in tutto il mondo penso è stato lasciato un po' a se stesso.
Yeah. He says 40 or 50 years that the artisans and craftspeople have been left to themselves, really, and that's it. It makes it quite difficult.
Mm-hmm. I want to jump back to that axe that came from your mentor. Yeah. One of our alumni would like to see the use of the axe that I interrupted earlier.
Buone lascia.
And while we're working on that, Emma, you might know the answer to this. Do we know the ratio of Venetian residents who have their own boats versus how many rely on the gondolas for transportation?
That's a good question. I don't know the answer offhand. I'll ask Paolo. Quanti veneziani hanno la barca con una percentuale di abitanti, più o meno, una cifra?
Ma non so, forse 10, 15, 20%.
But 10, 15, 20% of Venetians own their own boat, he thinks.
E ci sono alcuni che si appoggiano sui gondoliere per il trasporto?
No, no.
No, nobody here would use a gondola for everyday transport. They use boats, but not gondolas.
Quelli che hanno i soldi prendono dei taxi.
Yeah, the ones who've got lots of money take the water taxis.
Ma il resto prendono il vaporetto.
Everybody else gets the vaporetto. The plebs have to walk.
Poi certi hanno la barca, cioè quasi tutti hanno la barca per divertirsi, non tanto sì. Tanti si muovono con la barca, ma è difficile perché non c'è il parcheggio come potrebbe esserci su una città normale.
Right.
Non c'è un parcheggio dove puoi lasciare la barca senza... Cioè, diventa incustodita, diventa su un posto dove se arriva l'ambulanza non c'è il posto.
Okay.
Il problema è che non è una città normale, quindi... Una volta si faceva in un'altra maniera, ma adesso hanno messo dei regolamenti in cui non puoi muoverti.
Yeah. Yeah. He says a lot of Venetians who do own the boat have a boat for fun. There are some that use it for work every day and to get about the city, but a lot of them have the boats for pleasure. And it's very difficult in Venice now to get a mooring, and moorings can be very expensive, and it can also be a bit difficult. If you can't just park your boat anywhere. He said you used to be able to. That was as part of Venice's charm, was you just pulled up, parked your boat and got out like you would with a car. But now there's very specific areas where you can park your boat and certain stops where the ambulance has to come past, or you have to leave space for access to different buildings, or space for other larger boats to come past. So it's much, much more complicated than it used to be to own and drive or row your boat and then moor it in Venice.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's ready to show us the
app. Oh, please.
I don't know, Sebastiano, if you can get that one. He makes that look very, very, very easy.
Very easy.
He's not doing huge movements. They're actually quite small movements. But because of the weight of the axe, it's got a lot of power to carve these very hard woods. This is a skill that takes... Quanti anni per imparare a usarlo bene, Paolo?
Questo? Vabbè, questo io non lo uso ancora bene, mm-hmm. perché lo uso...
Yeah.
I want to ask him a technical question from one of our guests. Because of the stresses applied to the form of the forcola itself, grain is important. So can Paolo speak to the grain direction or the anything technical about the shape of the object?
So you can see the veins on the wood.
Il tronco prima. La venatura è dritta.
So the lines, the veins on the wood are very, very straight.
Vedete che il tronco è così, quindi viene su così, si prende il pezzo del quarto, si toglie, come ho detto prima, il centro.
Okay, so you take out the center.
E la venatura di qua è in questo senso, ma quando il legno è sano e non ha difetti, non c'è nessun problema, non si romperà mai da sola la forma.
Right, when it's a healthy chunk of wood,
ovviamente
he
devi
can
fare delle cure,
use the veins.
Girargli intorno, infatti questa morsa è così perché tu all'oggetto con il ferro tu la metti così, così,
right.
così, così, and perché devi seguire la venatura con il ferro qua, no?
Right.
E quindi ti questa morsa così che poi girargli intorno, puoi metterti in tutte le posizioni per lavorarci attorno, se no, se avessi un banco non potresti girarti.
Right, so he uses this questa vice a lot.
Vedi, ti giri, fai così,
yeah.
fai così, quindi...
Segui
per tagliare bene la venatura.
Yeah.
Ovviamente certe volte con questo ferro si va anche contro, ma... Questo ferro ci vuole due anni e mezzo per imparare a usarlo, quindi
okay.
quando lo sai usare bene fai tutti i giri che vuoi. Come
so,
diceva il mio maestro, quando lo sai usare è come giocare.
So Paolo says, this vice is made in this way so that you can get round the veins and the way the wood is. He says the wood is very solid in itself, to try and answer your question. And if it's a healthy trunk of wood, then he doesn't have huge problems with pieces splintering or knots because of the way the wood is formed, which is why that he uses walnut, because of how you can carve it. And the fact that it's got very straight veins in it, and that mm-hmm. helps create the shapes that he needs. But he says it's about access when he's carving. And he uses the draw knife, and he says the draw knife, you need about 2.5 years to learn to use it properly, to create all the different shapes. And he says it works because of the tools you're using and the way you're carving and the fact that you have a sort of 360 degree vice which enables you to go all the way around the object and look at it from all the different angles instead of just working head on as you would with a traditional workbench.
Mm-hmm. And that's a huge answer. And I mean, it sounds like the wood itself is sort of dictating a lot of what shape it takes as well. Well, it always ends up in the shape of a forcola, but I'm sure the wood dictates some of that.
Right.
The follow-up question is where are the woods coming from?
La legna ti dice esattamente la forma e come lavorarlo. E poi la seconda domanda è da dove arriva la legna?
Right. quando si taglia la forcola devi capire, metti lo stampo e tagli la forcola, no? Però
so you have to have,
devi avere il tronco e scegli la parte che ti sembra meglio per ricavare un tipo o un altro di forcola.
Right, so you do choose where you start on the tree.
Poi
trunk.
C'è anche
and you have a mold to follow a pattern.
Sfruttare, diciamo, tutto il pezzo, perché sul pezzo grande di legno devi togliere fuori una forcola da gondola di solito e dopo sapere che se ricavi un altro pezzo magari viene fuori una forcola così. Quindi quando si impara bisogna imparare anche a sfruttare al massimo il pezzo di legno per non buttare via
il materiale. That's very interesting. You said that with the wood you have to be able to work out which part of the wood you're going to use. Maybe if you're carving out an oarlock out of one side, if you carve it really well, you'll have enough wood to make a smaller oarlock, maybe like this one. From the same piece of wood, so you're not wasting what you've got. Your materials are always very precious, and you need to make the most out of what you have.
Il legno arriva quasi tutto dall'Europa dell'Est.
From Eastern Europe, the wood.
Macedonia, Ungheria.
Macedonia, Hungary.
Dove ci sono ancora delle foreste che diciamo c'è ancora un po' di noci, di alberi da sfruttare.
Where there are big old forests with the sort of wood that he needs to use for this.
Mm-hmm. Here's an interesting question from a guest. About your mentor. When your mentor saw potential in you to carry on this craft or trade, what was it specifically that he saw in you? Was it your hand skills, or was it your attention to detail, or your patience? Can you put your finger on that?
Allora, quando il tuo mentore ti ha visto il tuo lavoro, che cos'era in te che ha ispirato lui, che ha fatto vedere che in te c'erano le qualità? Erano la tua capacità, il tuo entusiasmo, era un'altra cosa?
Ma forse lui ha provato, mi ha detto fanne un'altra per capire se capivo qualcosa. Allora, quello che diceva lui degli allievi, diceva che il mestiere, se ti entra, boh, se no devi fare un altro mestiere. Cioè, se io ti insegno e tu capisci e fai, puoi andare avanti. Se non capisci niente, ti fermi a un certo punto.
Right.
Secondo me è un po' vero, un po' falso, però io aggiungerei che devi avere delle cose dentro da tirar fuori poi, quando hai imparato qualcosa.
Right, that's lovely. So he said that when his mentor saw this first forcola that he'd made in his uncle's workshop, he said to him, go make another one. I want to see, make this other one. And clearly there was something, he says it's a bit difficult to describe. It was some sort of passion, something inside you. And his teacher used to say, I can teach you the skills and I can show you how to work the wood. But if you haven't got the inspiration that you need to carry on, you're not going to be able to do anything. And
I think these visitors coming in might answer another question that we've had is does Paolo accept visitors into his shop?
Certainly does.
That's answered.
And so he has the working part of his shop where he repairs the oars and things, but he also does things for fun. He likes to play with the wood and carve wood and things he makes for his own pleasure, which he sells from his workshop too, to anybody that wants to come along. And we'll show you in a minute. He has the most beautiful bracelets there.
Right. That's the last question I want to ask. And while he's talking, I want to thank our guests. I'm not sure if we'll get to all of your questions because there's so many and they're so wonderful. Maybe we can do some follow-up on our end with your questions and get answers for them. But I do apologize if we couldn't get to your question. But I thank you for chiming in with so many great questions. And he's still busy, so let's give him another second.
I show you one of these while we're...
Yes, I wanted to ask, Paolo, my last question here is, what do you do, what things do you make for your own joy that are not forcola related?
Che cosa fai per il tuo piacere, per divertimento, che non è collegato alla forcola?
Allora, come ha mostrato lei, qualche bracciale in legno Vedete che
these bracelets
are so beautiful.
Really beautiful, absolutely.
Questo gorgeous. Sempre con i legni, questo è ciliegio e noce.
Cherry and walnut.
Con dei pezzi che avanzano anche con altri legni.
With his other wood, and he's used other woods as well to carve. Playing around with them, they're absolutely beautiful.
Paolo, we had another question. If you use,
and he has a cutting boards, chopping boards as well, which yes. I think I've been showing you up there.
E poi yes. avevo fatto anche degli anelli, delle collane.
And he made some rings and some necklaces as well.
A question that might tie into the bracelets, do you use any other tools like gouges or chisels?
Usi altri attrezzi tipo per tagliare le cose piccole, dare più dettagliato. C'è quello per tirare
lo scalpello.
Sì, per scavare.
No, molto raramente su qualche furcola dove non si arriva con quei ferri là. Ma...
Invece per i braccialetti, to make the bracelets?
Allora per i braccialetti uso spesso questo per fare l'interno.
He uses the draw knife, so he's still using the tools for the furcola.
Wow, modellare. For the bracelets? Wow.
Yep, even for the bracelets.
Allora, l'interno quasi sempre con questi.
Nearly always with the draw knife.
E poi l'esterno lo faccio spesso con la smerigliatrice, con quella.
He's got a sort of electric sander there in the background, which he uses to make them.
E poi ho con questo che.
Emma, will you ask him where?
He's got a sort of Dremel drill as well.
Will you ask him where his draw knife comes from?
Da dove arriva il non mi ricordo in italiano adesso the draw knife.
Questi allora parecchi sono ancora del mio maestro.
So a lot of these tools belonged to his mentor. Ancora... These are ones that his mentor used to use.
E qualcuno è nuovo, ma
made in Venice?
Erano fatti a Venezia, fatti a mano questi?
Una volta sì, perché once quei ferri li usavano tanti artigiani, ognuno si faceva fare il ferro come gli serviva.
Right, so yes, come a lot of artisans in Venice used to use it.
A prendere il coltello giusto, più o meno anche gli artigiani facevano le cose, come l'ascia, questa.
Like the axe.
Questa, solo quelli che fanno questo mestiere l'hanno così corta e così pesante.
Yeah. So only people who use it to carve the
quelli che facevano le gondole avevano questa più leggera col manico lungo perché le usavano.
Right, and people who make the gondola have an axe that's it's similar, yeah. but it's got a longer handle and it's a little bit lighter.
Larga.
Yeah. So the tools were made specifically for each different trade, and they were all handmade.
Anche molto piacevole, no, da vedere.
And you can see the details in the aesthetic there. They've had the iron that's been. Round of the nut and bolt. It's not IKEA.
Well, I'm going to take a pause there and again thank our guests for all of your wonderful questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of them. And I need to give a special thanks to Melissa Gallen, who's my colleague and friend who was the navigator of this whole program. Thank you, Melissa. And thank you, everyone. Emma, amazing. Sebastian, you've been amazing. And Paolo, thank you so much from Boston. We just thank you for sharing your space with us. And I'm hoping, I want to ask Sebastian if he can give us one last look at the canal before we all part ways.
Yeah, we'll see. It's actually started to rain, so we'll see how.
Oh, shoot. Oh, it's beautiful.
È il colore dell'acqua che fa la differenza.
Yeah, it's the color of the water that makes a difference.
It is. Thank you all so much. This has been such a wonderful end cap of our in the making year. It was wonderful. So thank you so much for your time, Paolo.
You're welcome.
Grazie, grazie. Thank you.
And Emma and all of our guests and Sebastian, take care and I will see you very soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye everyone.